joining us for the webinar on building capabilities for a digital ready organization, when, what, why, in partnership with Microsoft and KNOLSKAPE. I am Shweta from People Matters, and before speaking about today's agenda, let me give you a brief about today's topic. Digital is not just technology, it is a mindset. As we know, mindsets are the hardest to transform. This is precisely where HR plays a big role in facilitating organization success while transforming digitally. Recent research reports suggest that 82% of business leaders believe their organization will be digital businesses this year. Most importantly, 43% of business leaders surveyed believe digital skill sets are the biggest barrier to transformation. This webinar attempts to create an awareness of the role that HR will play this year and the next few years in helping companies adopt digital. The key outcomes from this webinar are: what do the digital building blocks actually mean for the business and for HR? The role of HR in equipping the workforce with the necessary digital skill sets. What does it take for HR to be proactive to meet the digital needs of their organization's clients? What are some of the future-ready competencies for digital? Let me now introduce you to the speakers for this webinar. We have the privilege of having with us Mr. Rajiv Jayaraman, CEO and founder, KNOLSKAPE. Rajiv Jayaraman is an in-seat MBA and a BITS Pilani alumnus. Over the last few years, he has built a high-octane team that delivers stellar technology-driven learning experiences for learners across the globe. A TEDx speaker, Rajiv has delivered keynote speeches at various national management conferences. He has delivered guest lectures at INSEAD, IIM Bangalore, IIT Madras, IIFT Delhi, NMIMS, and MICA. Rajiv's deep passion for technology, design, and learning helps him build impactful next-gen learning products. We have with us Dr. Parul Pandey, Director, L&D, Microsoft India. Dr. Parul Pandey, Director, Learning and Development, Microsoft India, leads the design and execution of Microsoft India Learning and Development Strategy. She completed her PhD in HRM from Punjab University and Master's in Applied Psychology from Delhi University. Over 20 years of experience as an HR professional, Parul has played multiple roles in HR, her last one being Country Head Talent and Development for DBOI Global Services. She led a countrywide cultural transformation intervention. Prior to that, Parul was director and co-founder of People Factor Private Limited. This webinar is first in series of webinars that we bring to you as a part of the Reimagine HR series in association with Microsoft. You can visit the Reimagine HR page on our website, www.peoplematters.in, or follow #Reimagine to know more and keep yourself updated. Our partner for today's webinar is Microsoft Azure and KNOLSKAPE. Microsoft Azure is an open and flexible cloud platform that enables customers to quickly build, deploy, and manage apps across the global network of Microsoft managed data centers. The platform underscores companies' commitment to consistently evolve and deliver quality solutions using technology to its consumers. The platform today hosts large-scale critical applications for businesses across verticals with seamless integration with existing infrastructure and financially backed SLAs. KNOLSKAPE. KNOLSKAPE is an award-winning immersive gamification and simulation software company focusing on talent transformation. Using experiential learning products, KNOLSKAPE helps organizations attract, grow, and retain talent. Global Fortune 500 companies and top 10 B schools use KNOLSKAPE's products and solutions for onboarding, training, assessments, and talent engagement. We have saved time for you to ask questions at the end of the webinar. For those attending the live webinar, you can submit questions anytime during the presentation through the Q&A section. We will try to respond to as many questions as time allows. We have an exciting agenda for today. So, without any further delay, I am going to hand over the webinar microphone to Rajiv and Parul. Over to you.
Thank you, Shweta. This is an absolute pleasure, and we'd love to have this engaging 1 hour with all of you. Seeing that we have a huge number of HR professionals on the list, it'll be exciting. It'll be like a learning experience for both sides. It will be equally enriching and learning for us as well. So without much ado, we will probably just take 2 minutes in introducing ourselves, and then I'll hand over to Rajiv. So as Shweta just gave a brief on my profile, essentially I'm an HR professional by profession, but an entrepreneur by temperament, which basically makes me look at all organizations across various systems, processes, and see how to create success in that organization. So through this webinar, I'll be talking about my experiences in supporting small and large organizations through either leadership development or cultural transformation or business change management. So my privilege, and over to you, Rajiv.
So good afternoon, everyone. My name is Rajiv Jayaraman. Absolutely delighted to spend this 1 hour with all of you, experts in the HR domain. So I'm the founder and CEO of KNOLSKAPE. We are a global top 20 gamification company. We work with about 150 clients across 10 different countries, helping organizations onboard, develop capabilities, assess, and engage talent using gamification, anytime, anywhere, and mobile learning. So these are the three design pillars that we use. So in the last 7 years, we've had the good fortune of working with some great minds in the learning and development space. And the specific theme that we have taken for today's workshop is something that is, I'm sure, playing on all of our minds. You know, digital is upon us. We know it is transforming and disrupting many industries, but are we ready for it? And as HR professionals and L&D professionals, what is our answer to it? You know, how do we transform our organizations in this business context? So that's the focus for the webinar today, and I'm really happy to co-host it with Dr. Parul Pandey. So in the next 40-odd minutes, we will follow the agenda that's on the screen. We'll firstly take a peek into the future. We will look at a few trends that are playing out as we speak, and extrapolating it from here, what future might look like for organizations and especially talent. Then we will look at, you know, what does organizational readiness for digital look like? What are some things that we need to think about? And what are some unique digital competencies, right? So we can't be still thinking about industrial competencies. This is the information age, and specifically digital age, and more specifically an exponential age, right? So the competencies for digital are, I think, very different from the industrial competencies. And finally, what does modern workplace learning look like, right? And what are some enabling environments that we need to think about for the new age digital learner? So that's the agenda for the webinar today. So let me take you through a peek into the future. Firstly, starting with what is happening right now. I'm sure we've seen this picture at some point floating around on Facebook or LinkedIn. What this actually tells us is in 5 minutes, right, this is the amount of content that is being generated. If you just look at a few data points here, 5 million videos viewed in just 5 minutes. We're talking about 88,000 calls made on Skype, 1,100 photos being uploaded on Flickr, right? Almost 500,000 tweets on Twitter. All this is happening in just 5 minutes. So in this age of, you know, information and user-generated content and digital, you know, what does an organization have to do to enable ourselves? So I'm a big fan of quizzing. I'm going to ask you some trivia questions to just to get your attention and interest. 90% of world's information was produced in the last how many years? You may want to use the Q&A box or the chat window to provide your responses. 90% of world's information was produced in the last how many years? Okay, Sanjeev says 10 years. 1 year, 1 year, 10 years, last 5 years, 1 year, 5 years, 3 years. Okay, brilliant. So I'm going to give you the answer. Well done, folks. I mean, the participation is just heartening. Probably a lot of you are answering these questions and quite accurately as well. I'll give you the answer. 90% of world's information has been produced in the last 2 years. It's a mind-boggling number if you think about it. We are living through it as we speak. We are producing enormous amounts of content, right? If you think about what is actually driving it, it is a combination of two things. One is user-generated content. That is you and I with our mobile phones and broadband access. On a daily basis, we are all content producers, right? Second is Internet of Things. We've got sensors all over, right, producing a lot of data, and that is creating massive amounts of insight, right, and information which can potentially mine for value production. Now, how are businesses transforming in this digital age? Let's first start with the consumer, because we've spoken about client-centric behaviors for a long time, but I do frankly believe that we've just been paying lip service to it. But today, if you're not really client-centric or customer-centric, you will soon become redundant, right? So why do I say this? Because back in the day, in the industrial age, in industrial thinking or mindset, one size was fitting all of us, or we were putting up with it. But today, if you look at it, we want products and solutions to fit like a glove, right? We want things to be absolutely right for us, right? So if you really think about it, you know, we want things to be personalized. We want things to work just right for us. So if we don't understand our customers well, we'll soon become redundant. So that's the alarming wake-up call that digital has for us. Now, a second trivia question. How many hours of activity does the digital consumer have in a day? So, of course, we know a day is 24 hours. How many hours of activity does he have in a day? 20 hours, 18 hours, 18 hours? 8 hours, okay. Sandeep, I wish that was true. Savio says 24 hours. Anand says 24 hours out of 24 hours, right, is activity driven. Okay, 10 hours, 12 hours. Now, here is the insight, a very, very crucial insight. As it turns out, an average consumer has 31 hours of activity in a day, and I'm sure you're thinking, how can that be possible? There are only 24 hours in a day, right? Now, the reason why it is 31 is the amount of multitasking that we manage to do, right? While we are listening to music, we are reading a book, and we are chatting with our friends on WhatsApp, right? It's all happening at the same time. So if you take activities and you add up all these activities, it is in excess of 31 hours in a day, right? So what does that mean? It means that we are all short of time and attention span, and if something doesn't really bear any relevance, so if something is not relevant to me, if it doesn't catch my attention, chances are no matter how good the product is or the service is, it will not work, right? Because it will not reach the intended audience. So the point here is, how do we become client-centric? How do we, think of the unique needs of individual clients and cater to that in a very unique way, in a very personalized way? And out of these 31 hours, 17 hours is being spent on consuming media and education. And here's where we all come in, right? So it's not like the consumers are not spending time on education. They are. But somehow, inside organizations, I'm sure you'll agree with me, we are chasing up after our employees to come into our classroom. So there's something that's going wrong here. So we need to think differently about how we deliver learning to our employees. So lifestyle of 70% of global consumers revolves around digital enablers. If you think about it, today everything that we need for our daily life has become an app, from hailing a cab to food to transferring money. Everything is on your mobile phone. So there are a lot of digital enablers around us. And the reality today is, multi-generations, digital natives and immigrants, I'm sure we're all familiar with this. The next generation is growing up in a very different paradigm. For them, 31 hours in a day is the norm. They are able to blend things digitally and in real life really well, and it's not really compartmentalized. Pick an activity, the consumption channel for this activity has become digital, be it news, food, careers, network, relationships. But a lot of things in HR are still not digital, right? So, and that's really something that we need to think about clearly. And one crucial insight here is how power is clearly shifting into the hands of the consumer and into the hands of the employees. It should, right? And the crucial insight here is back in the day when technology innovation used to happen, enterprises used to lead it, right? Think about mainframes. The companies used to invest in it and make some advancements, and over time, these innovations got into the hands of consumers. But today, what is happening is consumers are the first ones to get all these innovations, and enterprises are lagging behind, right? Enterprises are figuring out a way to cope up with some of these changes that are happening in the consumer space. Now, the crucial question is, if all this is true, the digital is upon us, how do we actually transform ourselves? So I couldn't have asked for a better co-host to answer this question than Parul. Parul, if you can come in here and talk about how Microsoft as an organization has prepared firstly itself, also preparing Microsoft's clients to transform digitally. What are some best practices that, that you can share with us?
Great, thanks. Thanks Rajiv for that beautiful transition and segue into how really the customer profile is changing, the customer expectations are changing, particularly because of the way digital world has seeped into our everyday life. So there was a time that Microsoft used to be focused only on platforms. Our Office was our product and devices were the platforms. And the kind of people that we used to hire, the kind of profiles that you know, our leaders were of, essentially were of that category where we would say, just go there, make a kill, do that sale, and you know, make sure that you get the business in. We were leaders in the market. In the very, very, very recent past, Microsoft realized that our position has changed into being a challenger position in the market. And we also are very fortunate to get our new leader, Satya. So the whole transformation started from there. It actually started a little before Satya came in, but the transformation really peaked when he came in with his new thoughts. And how HR had to completely revamp the way we looked at the organization, the way we defined success, the way we looked at our customers. We no more are that one product company. We said the same manpower, the same human resource is now going to cater to the new business model, which is essentially about solutioning. We are going to make the customer center of our business. We're going to figure out how to make every human being on the planet more productive, empower every human being to do more. So that was a massive, massive mission that Microsoft took on. And, you know, as we go forward, we'll really talk about what we did and how we, you know, supported that change and where are we today? What are some of our challenges? And in this digital world, how can some other organizations, irrespective of size, learn from us and vice versa? So before I really get into that, you know, coming back to HR, very slowly, subtly, but surely, all of us in HR now have far larger role to play in the organization. We don't just talk about talent. We don't just talk about culture. We talk about what's our strategy. So if the strategy is changing from A to B, then everything else has to have a touch point for us. And we are equal partners. So it's important for us to look at the questions that we see now on the slide. And I really want to you know, engage all the audience here. Why don't we see in our respective industries and respective companies, for example, does our company have the right strategy, the right leadership and focus required for digital? So I'm going to wait to see all of you respond on the chat boxes. Just look at Capgemini, Virtuosa, you know, Lap India. I can see we have representation from amazing different set of companies. Do you think the organization that you work in has the right strategy? Ooh, no luck, still struggling. Okay. Anybody else? Let's also see customer engagement. As we all know now, the customer profile has significantly changed. Before making, all of us also, before making a buying decision, we know where all to check. We know all the information that's required for competing products. We sometimes also want the producer to involve us before the design is made. So invariably, the way all of us relate with digital content, with products based or sold on digital world, we want to be part of decision making right up front. So the profile of customers has changed from consumers to prosumers. We are part of the production process for anything that we consume. And we love to give back. You see the Wikipedia, the open source content. A lot of Microsoft customers and clients are partners for us because they use our open source, they create products, and that is what gives us the leverage. That is what gives us the scale to reach out to empower every human being in the on the planet. So let's look at customer engagement. Do we use data? Do we use more contact with customer? Do we anticipate what our customers would require in the near future? In our companies, do we have a strategy for customer engagement? I'm waiting to see on the chat boxes. It's also going to be interesting for me to see how many HR people really think of, the business strategy, the customer engagement. Because at the end of the day, we also need to remember that the fact that there was a time when we used to call all employees of the organization internal customers, for us, that was the world. But today, that really isn't true. The definition for HR contribution has significantly changed. If we don't understand the end customer, and if we don't treat our internal customers, that is our employees, as partners, we tend to lose out on a lot of significant contribution that we can make. And invariably, the end customer then experiences us suboptimally because we look at employees as the end for our deliverables. So it'll be interesting to see how many of us understand customer engagement processes for our companies. Anyone who'd like to put in opinions about how their company does customer engagement?
Parul, if I may come in here.
Yeah, Rajiv.
Yeah, so the one way to think about it is, does digital actually mean creating a mobile app and making it easy for the customer? Is that what we're talking about? Or is it something more? In other words, what are some things that you think should change for an organization to become really digital?
Absolutely. So let's hear from our participants. So there is no bridge or toll-free number available, there's somebody asking? Okay. I think there is a parallel chat that I couldn't figure out. All right, let's go ahead. We will involve our audience a little more a little later. So essentially, what needs to change? For example, in Microsoft, let me talk about Microsoft and then that will be a trigger. In Microsoft, our customer engagement essentially has completely changed from what it used to be. So if for example, let's look at the Salesforce. If they're going to a sales call, there is an online support for them, which is quick on-the-go learning about the customer, about the product, data that could give them insights into the customer buying profile, customer decision makers, and how those decision makers are networked with them. So overall, the enabling environment and then the mindset to use this kind of information works very well in Microsoft for us. Let's look at organization and talent, for example. Does your company have the right people, talent, and skills to support the strategy? This is something I would love to hear from all the HR folks. Do you think we have talent that is digital ready, digital savvy? Do we have leaders focusing on connecting the way the digital world, the new digital native population connects? So some are saying, not really, we are investing heavily into digital. leadership team not willing to? Very interesting. Okay, a lot of us are saying yes. Interesting. We'll go deeper into some of these questions and see how we can, as HR professionals, support this talent development and talent management. Let's see how some of the, not only the new age companies, but large organizations are really currently disrupting their business models. And what is going to happen in the near future to the current talent? What are the demands that they're going to have? And how can they be productive in this environment? So we know that one big disruption is coming from Uber and Uber-like aggregator organizations, to the extent that they're currently actually thinking about 15 years from now, would they really need the drivers they're hiring today? So self-disrupting business models are coming. Will we really look at driverless cars, at least in some parts of the world, in the very near future, managed by Uber? Netflix is another such model, which is directly coming into the customer's world, letting the customer decide what they want, and then designing backend accordingly. Even manufacturing companies, for that matter, the robots that are coming in, very near future, we'll start seeing robots replacing manpower. Zappos actually is a very interesting company, and I'd like it's a good segue into our next topic that we're going to talk about and how HR can support. So Zappos was a shoe retail company in US, and it's the CEO, Tony Say, actually talked about how innovation and productivity relates to the size of the organization. So he says that in every city, when the number of citizens double, the productivity and innovation actually goes up by 15%. But in an organization, if the organization size doubles, both productivity and innovation per person goes down. So they've restructured the organization in a manner that enhances productivity and innovation, and they say we want to grow like cities. So it's one interesting model, and similar philosophy-based models can be looked at as we support our organizations. And you see Yammer there, which actually represents Microsoft, because in Microsoft also massive transformation is going on, and right from structure to the way we manage processes is changing. So I would actually go on to the next slide and talk a little bit about how the structure is changing and what are the impact. So let's see this, that in traditional companies, as all of us have seen and some of us still experience, there were job descriptions, fixed roles as to what the job holder would be doing, delegated authority. And any change would really need a whole lot of, work around restructuring, reorganizing, lots of consultant engagements. And we still, in our current large organizations, experience a lot of this. Now, let's see the right side of the slide. It talks about something called holacracy, which I wouldn't talk so much about this particular word, but it's a philosophy. Holacracy is a new system or structure in an organization which is based on self-managing teams, evolving teams, but in an overall larger, consistent framework. So it's not laissez-faire, but people in the teams are empowered, there is distributed authority. It's instead of job descriptions, it is roles, and the roles are empowered irrespective of who holds that role. We know what unique contribution is required out of that role. So Zappos, incidentally, implemented this structure, and there is lots of literature around insights on how it is working. So the whole managerial cadre, the bureaucratic policing roles, the any such role which would govern or take away the decision power from the person who is directly handling the customer has been eradicated. So it's a very interesting structure, and you would see similar changes in technology companies, the whole agile methodology, lean manufacturing, and something that even in Microsoft we have done and is a very powerful shift and a massive shift. is that we used to have teams of engineers who would develop solutions and code on a regular basis, structured in the conventional manner. We had a tester, we had a coder, and we had a program manager. And we realized that if the number of builds that have to go on a weekly basis and have to be worked closely with the customer, we'll have to merge a lot of these roles. So at least the tester and the coder roles merged. And that was a massive transformation for us. Now, the person who's coding is equally responsible, accountable for the quality of the code. And we are currently managing this change. It actually falls in line with the new philosophy of come closer to the customer, be accountable to the role contribution, and there is no requirement for management, so to say, when it comes to quality and customer contact. I will hold here for a bit to check if you're experiencing this change in your companies. Do you see the demand to restructure, to change ways in order to contribute better to clients? Is there conversation? Is there leadership focus there? Right. I can see that a lot of us are talking about gap between leaders and the teams. Leadership focus not very clear. But most of us actually do experience this change that is happening around us. Yes, owing to the risk concept is coming. Yes, owing the risk concept is coming to all of us, owning the risk, absolutely. So the person who's delivering needs to own the quality, the risk, and accountability, and to the extent that in Microsoft, the way we experience it is that the build is shipped. And it has shipped at such a short notice that the support team, which is probably sitting in a third location, is not even yet aware. So the whole HR support mechanisms, the learning mechanisms that we have to cater to, are the kinds that people can learn on the go. Here is a person who is going to actually support an application or a system or a software, which he has not seen earlier. So on the go, he has to use everything that is on his mobile to make sure that he effectively services the customer. So that's what is transforming and changing for us. And as we change, it's also important for HR personnel to figure out how are we going to change. This is a Herculean task, and I'm seeing a lot of you put that chat there, that leadership, for example, is either not focusing or we are struggling. How do we do this? If we start looking at this as a whole organization and we say, we have to find out my change champions. Who are those who are either natives of this digital world or natives of the new change that we're talking about? Who are the ones who will need more hand-holding? So you have digital disruptors, you have people who are digital makers, who are figuring out what are the customer needs, and you also have enablers. And usually, a lot of hurdles and a lot of objections that you hear will come from the enablers, people who are not really directly in touch with the customers, but are supporting. So product experts or system experts or data experts, governance experts, for example. These are people from where you might hear objections or issues, and that is where you would need to handle. But identify your change champions and lead the change accordingly. That's what is important. I think what I skipped earlier, and I will quickly go back to, is this. What is the role of HR in bringing this digital change? So you've identified your change champions, but there are touch points where you have to really look at contribution at each level. So what's the strategy? What's the leadership focus? Are we doing enough workforce development and in the right manner? Is the user or the customer focus there? And finally, what's the culture? What is the enabling environment? in early times, as we see, they were aimed at, you know, strategy was aimed at cost reduction or profit maximization. Today, we aim it at a very fundamental transformational level. It has to be customer value, making a difference, contribution to the world, solving problems. And that in itself is a massive shift, and HR has to find a role in that. How does HR, what is HR's role in a strategy like that? Asking clear questions. Is it fundamentally going to change something? If we are changing this, then how do we define success? What is the strategy for improving, say, customer experience? How are we going to use the digital world, which is the social media, mobility, analytics? How are we going to use all that to make sure that we reach the customer and we use the customer intelligence? So HR has a very strategic role to play in each one of these. In fact, I can actually share for leadership development. In one of my earlier organizations, we realized that while the younger generation was very good at digital, we used to have a Yammer-like platform and a lot of learning communities and exchanges to happen there. We know that successful leaders are the ones who are digitally sophisticated, but in large organizations like ours, sometimes we feel leaders don't take it easily. They don't take to this easily. So in one of the programs that we ran, which was Leaders Develop Leaders, use of webinars, use of chats, virtual mentoring, and blogging were essential tools for leaders to use to develop other leaders. So we realized that every leader is very interested in developing others, but the tools became hindrances. So slowly getting them in, training them, it made a lot of difference. They themselves felt a lot empowered. So as you go down, you basically look at what HR can contribute in each of these, and particularly culture. We have all the tools in organizations. We have the intranet. We have the learning community tools. We have the LMSs. We have intelligence and analytics. But putting that all together is, I think, a very critical contribution that HR can make. So that was around structuring and overall HR contribution to making us digital or digital ready. At this juncture, actually, I'll move to Rajiv. Would you like to take us through the digital leadership framework, Rajiv?
Sure, Parul. Thank you so much for giving us the context for organizational transformation. And as some of us rightly pointed out in the chat window, you know, there is a huge need, but leadership is not focused. And when I say leadership here, I'm not really referring to the top leader. Leadership can happen anywhere inside the organization, and more so these days where the youngsters have a lot of new ideas. Right, so this leadership has to be tapped across different levels. So what I'm going to do in the next few slides is share with you some of the work done by MIT Sloan on digital leadership. And I think there's a fairly robust model to look at what we need to focus on in terms of the overall and what is the impact on the competencies when we look at our talent. So here it goes. So digital leadership involves three aspects. One is transforming the customer experience. So one thing I think we all realize is, you know, as consumers, when we use digital, customer experience is number one. Right, we don't like to wait even for a few seconds. If the website doesn't load up, we just switch to the next one, don't we? So you know, that customer experience has become so important, and in that context, understanding the customer, where they come from, what is unique about that customer, what are their needs, and how do I fulfill that need so well that I can drive my top line and grow, and what are the various customer touch points? And this is also true, right? So today customers can reach out to an organization on the phone, come directly to the office. You have AT, you've got mobile, webs. Customers more often don't come to you. They go to a social media site and bash you up over there. How can you be proactive in reaching out to customers and fulfill their needs uniquely, right? So that requires a very responsive mindset. It is unlike a product mindset or a service mindset where you say, I've got something, the customers will come to me. So now you have something and you have to go closer to the customer. So that requires a different kind of an outlook. So that's the first component. The second one is transforming operational processes. This is slightly inward looking, where you're talking about process digitization, worker enablement. And I'm sure a lot of us are aware of the needs for sales training, for example, right? The sales folks in various organizations are out there on the street. They need to be trained constantly because in this VUCA world, the products are changing, customer dynamics are changing, but how does the learning happen for these feet on the street? Or it could be channel partners. Many companies today work with channel partners and they need to be trained constantly on your changes in your business model. How does that training happen, right? So how do you enable people to help themselves? And finally, one of my pet areas is performance management. I know, you know, all of us are clued into this, the classic bell curve and the annual performance management system that is coming under the radar right now. And that's for a good reason, because again, one size does not fit all. We need to you know, factor into the aspirations of employees individually as well. So these are some transforming in operational processes. And finally, if you look at it, there are transforming business model opportunities as well. So how do you you know, make use of digital globalization? How do you get into markets that you are not able to access earlier, the classic blue ocean, right? And new digital businesses. And you'll notice that many companies that are using digital these days are usually using digital only to augment their already existing business. So that's an incremental approach. But digital in many industries offers an opportunity to extract a new revenue opportunity. What do you do with the data that you're collecting, right? Is that a new revenue opportunity? There's not enough thought going into how can we make use of digital to unlock new revenue opportunities. So fundamentally rethink how business models work. So if you define digital transformation along these three major buckets, that is customer experience, operational process, and transforming business model, what does it translate to in terms of competencies that we need to develop? One is, when you think about customer experience, voice of the customer, how do we go closer to the customer? As Pavel was mentioning earlier, this might have an impact on the way we structure ourselves, the holacracy and giving autonomy to people to go closer to the customers, empower them to act fast so that customer issues are solved real time. So the voice of customer and being responsive becomes a very crucial skill to have. Second is design thinking. I'm sure a lot of you are evaluating programs internally for design thinking. This has become so crucial because, again, the whole process here, the fundamental power shift to the consumer has happened. So unless we empathize with them, we ideate, we iterate over their needs and solve issues and problems that they have uniquely, it will not be seen as valuable. So design thinking is one of the most important, you know, mindsets, I would say, that we need in the digital world. The third one is data-enabled decisions. This is tied to what I was saying earlier about the amount of information that we have access to. But unless we are able to harness all that data and derive some insights, you know, it's all going to waste. We might actually be chasing after some spurious trends, right? So data-enabled decision is extremely crucial. And agile project management, so as we deal with constant shifts in customer preferences, internal processes, intense change management is extremely important, and being agile is super crucial. The one thing that I would like to highlight here is how interestingly Microsoft and KNOLSKAPE, Microsoft, one of the largest companies in the world, KNOLSKAPE, an emerging startup, on the same platform talking about the same concept, right? So now it is not about big or small, it is about who is fast and who is slow, right? And that is a new ground for competition, right? So being agile is extremely important. SMAC enabled, I'm sure we are all familiar with this acronym SMAC. Anyone here who knows what SMAC stands for? I'm sure all of us will nail it. What does SMAC, S-M-A-C stand for? Okay, social, absolutely right. Social, mobility, analytics, and cloud. right? Social mobility analytics and cloud. So we need to enable ourselves. So you take SMAC and you apply it on your business model, every single process that you have, a customer touch point you have, lends itself well for a transformation. If you apply social principles to it, if you apply mobility, analytics, cloud, every single thing is a new opportunity. And finally, managing and collaborating across virtual and global teams. And today we're talking about a lot of part-time workforce as well. And it's a significant trend. So how do you collaborate, extract the best out of virtual teams? So I think these are some big changes that we need to make in terms of the way we look at our talent in the digital future. And I'll pass this over to Parul now to take us through, what are some specific mindsets that are required for digital strategy execution and developing this digital mindset. Perhaps, we can start with design thinking. Parul, if you can weigh in on this, how crucial was this for Microsoft?
Sure, absolutely. So it's so beautifully put that, conventionally we call it skill sets. But it's really not about skill sets. It's really about, does this come to your mind as first option? Does solutioning come to your mind as first option? So when we move from simple one or two siloed products to saying, no, we're going to stitch up solutions for clients, we're going to use across board the solutions, the products that we have, it was a completely new skill set required. So for our sales force, to be able to be masters on all was very difficult. We couldn't really have masters on all products because we've always been trained on product knowledge and the depth of knowledge. Suddenly now it was breadth, not only breadth, but to stitch it up all together along with the customer to give a solution to the customer's problem. So design thinking essentially was something like that. Go to the customer, work on the problem that the customer has, and co-create multiple options and solutions, create a prototype, and then work with that. There were sometimes that they had to make changes. There were sometimes that instead of closing the deal in 1 month or 2 months, it took much longer time. But that competency needed to be developed, and we're still working on developing that competency. So design thinking, you're absolutely right, is a very critical piece, and we're working on that. Another piece that is very critical is teamwork. While, it comes from our conventional competency definitions, but in a new digital world, teamwork is very different. So as I said that, in real-time situations, people have to solve problems on their toes, on the go. If they're not networked either within the organization or outside with experts, it becomes very difficult. If they're not digital savvy, it becomes very difficult for them to resolve problems at the speed that they need to resolve. So it's all actually, it falls in place to make and to ensure that the customer, the end customer, gets the best out of Microsoft. I think these are two critical ones that I wanted to talk about. Rest, most HR people would know, how critical the others are as well. So back to you.
Thanks, Parul. So just on teamwork, I just wanted to highlight the multi-generational the aspect as well. So while the newer generation has latched on to quicker, faster real-time communication methodologies, some of the older people in the organization may not be quite as savvy, and that this difference could happen between a leader and the millennial as well. So we need to factor this in while we take care of teamwork. The other thing that really has been something that a lot of companies are looking at, one is agile, the lean methodology. How do you do processes in a very agile fashion, in a lean fashion, so that you don't waste resources and you build only after you measure something? It's a very scientific mindset to building things in the digital world. So moving on to the next topic here. So we've so far looked at, what is changing in the digital world, how do you measure your own organizational readiness, and what are some competencies that we need to focus on for the digital world? All this is great, but how do we actually enable the learner, right? So we need to fundamentally rethink the way modern workplace learning happens. And I'm happy to share some of the insights that we've gained over the last few years. So the one clear trend that's happening here is many companies are, shifting the accountability for learning to the learner. So for the longest time, I think it's been orchestrated carefully, aligned with the organizational needs. But ultimately, until the learner is empowered, the change in behavior doesn't happen. Right? And if the change in behavior doesn't happen, business results don't happen. So I see that a lot of companies are, moving towards personalization of learning, right? From, starting from modernizing the training content to building communities, informal learning, mobile learning, surrounding the learner with multiple options so that they can pick what works for them. So while all this is going on, the one danger, of course, is we know that as the power shifts to an individual, a lot of the success depends on the motivation of the individual. This is like going to the gym, right? No one's actually asking us to do it. It's up to us. How many of us are actually motivated on a daily basis to go to the gym, right? So we need some scaffolding or mechanism to motivate people to do what is good for them. Learning is great for people for keeping up with the changing times. So that's where gamification we've seen has worked out really well. You know, social approaches and rewards and, points, badges, leaderboards, levels, the constant feedback that you get, all these are great mechanisms to motivate an individual to complete, what is good for them. And we also noticed that, anytime, anywhere, learning is extremely crucial, especially in India. A lot of us are stuck in traffic. How can we maximize that time for our learning, right? And I do this regularly. I play on Elevate or Peak, the Brain Gym apps. How cool would it be if I could train myself on something that is more relevant to work, right? So anytime, anywhere learning is extremely crucial. And thirdly, I think we've just barely managed to scratch the surface when it comes to analytics. A lot can be done because it's learner-centric and they're doing something with the system. We can harness that data to create a great talent map for the digital world. So, Parul, maybe you can weigh in here on some modern workplace practices at Microsoft. How do you enable learning for Microsoft employees?
Rajiv, I'm also conscious of time. Maybe we could leave that for the Q&A. I can see that, we're almost close to closure. So I quickly mention that there is, we realize that, yes, learner has to be at the steering wheel. The learner has to feel the need to develop. And we also have a process of support mechanism through app and interaction with coaches and mentors where the learner can really design his or her own learning journey. So for any details, I would be happy to, give those a little later.
Wonderful. Sounds good. We're happy to take any questions that you may have.
Great. Thank you so much, Parul and Raji, for such engaging discussion. It was a bang since the first slide it began. So, yes, we have a lot of questions pouring in, and without any further delay, I would, ask you the first question, which is from Dhruv. So, Dhruv wants to ask that having agreed that digital is the way forward, but such an impetus being held on digital, are we losing the human touch points? So he wants to know how much digitization is essential and is important.
Is that
pointed to Rajiv or me, or either of us can respond?
Either of you can answer.
So I'll give it from the organizational context and bang on. I think sometimes we really feel that if you can walk across and talk, why would you want to use a ping or a chat? Absolutely bang on. You do need communities. You do need people to interact with each other. But the other reality is also very critical, which is we are getting more and more virtual with the traffic on the road. People are more and more working from homes. Teams are across geographies and sitting in various places across the world, different time zones. If we don't leverage digital, if we are not natives of digital, we lose out on that piece. So while digital does bring in this side effect or hazard, we also need to know that the next generation is really growing up with this. They're okay to sit next to each other and still chat. So absolutely bang on. I think it's essential, but that's also the way forward for more productivity, more ideas, and more innovation. So that's how I would look at it.
Sure.
Please.
Yeah, Sanjeev is asking a question about, how do we bring digital in firms where access to information inside or outside is restricted due to client requirements? What we've seen is, something like a mobile app where you can download all the content that you want when you have the access, right? And do this, while at work or just outside of work, right? So this is truly anytime, anywhere learning. And having a personalized learning path on your mobile phone is a great way to stay connected. And this is downloaded, you don't need internet access, it's on your system. So I think that's one thing we've seen a lot of companies do. So I'm gonna take the next question on organizations that are willing to digitize. So we've seen that, we usually look at this as a four-lane highway. The lane number one is the digital lane, right, where companies are already digital, like Microsoft and Amazon and a lot of other companies that are at the cutting edge of digital. Lane two is the fast lane, where companies have realized that digitization is important for them, and they are in the transformational path. They're quickly shifting into lane one. Lane three is sort of the experimental companies that are experimenting with some core processes, and they're not really sure. And lane four are companies that believe that digital is not the way forward for them, right? So the one thing you could ask yourself is, where are we in terms of lane one through four? And you could use the template, the checklist that we had earlier to make a determination of which lane you belong to, right? And accordingly, the challenges for each lane would be different. So you can use the MIT framework to see where will I start? Will I start with the customer transformation or internal transformation or business model? I think it's important to make the right start so that it succeeds and the digital as a culture will stick with the organization.
Sure, perfect. So Rajiv, as you can see, Rajiv and Pavel, we have so many questions pouring in, and we've just received one from Arushi Anand. So she wants to know how we curate and design the employee engagement in digital age.
I'm glad you asked about curation and designing the experience, and you didn't really talk about just the content, right? So the one change I think is going to happen mainly from a learning side. Learning teams will no longer be required to create content. Curation is the right word that you use, because there's a plethora of content that's already available, and cutting edge content too, right? So if you think about a Coursera, you think about Udemy, you've got content. But the one thing that is still missing is the context, right? While there is a lot of information out there, what does it mean for me? What does it mean for my job, my career progression, or my team, or my organization? I think that's where the next wave of innovation needs to happen. While a lot of content is out there, I think the learning teams can start focusing on contextualizing that for your organization. So I think I would focus not so much on content, but what is the learner experience? Right. We speak about pedagogy. I think that should go out of the window very soon. We should start focusing on andragogy, and something that we are working on currently called neurogogy, because in all this, we are not really thinking about how does a human brain actually learn. Right. So there's so much advancement in neuroscience that we've not tapped into. So I think the role of an L&D has to become more scientific, really in understanding how is it that people learn new things. Right, and enable that. So you are bang on when you say that, curation and designing of experience is what this role is all about.
Sure, thank you for answering that, Rajiv. So we have one more question from Drona. So he's asking, there are two sides to every coin. Just wanted to understand the other side. That is, what can be the possible setbacks of digital transformation?
Parul, you want to take that?
It's a very interesting and a tricky question. You're right. There are two sides to every change. And, if we were to start looking at what could go wrong or what could be side effects or what could be derailers, I do think that that would take another, few minutes. But upfront, I think what we need to understand and appreciate is that that really looks like the direction that corporates are going through. That really looks like the direction that the new generation is going into. So it is more a philosophical question on whether digital really is the way towards healthy life, work-life balance, towards a larger, peaceful existence. So I think it's a lot more complicated than what we can right now address. Happy to take this maybe a little later, but upfront, this is the direction, and we should ensure that we continue to keep our balance. As you hear so much about digital, you also equally, importantly hear about spiritual. So I'm hoping that balance is going to evolve, and we will go in the right direction.
Thank you so much, Farul, for answering them that question. And we have a lot of questions, but unfortunately, we have completely run out of time. So we will take all that questions offline and would request both of you to answer them. And with this question and answer session, we are going to wrap up today's webinar. So once again, we thank today's webinar partner, Microsoft and KNOLSKAPE. And of course, our special thanks to both our speakers, Rajiv and Farul, for this webinar and the invaluable information that they have shared with us today. And I would like to thank everyone in the webinar audience for participating in today's presentation. So we will definitely come back to you with many more. So with this, we conclude today's webcast. And thank you, everyone, and have a great day ahead.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Bye.